Hey everybody, how's it going? My name's Paul. I started the DiceyReview.com, and on this rainy afternoon, I am going to go over how to play a game called The Voyages of Marco Polo. You can see the board right here, and then down below you can see your little your player board that you'll be using. This is the cover of the game. This is what it looks like, The Voyages of Marco Polo. This is the rule book, but this is the same picture on the front of the cover. So I thought I would go ahead and give kind of an overview of how this game plays and the different things that you can do, including the setup. And I was a bit hesitant to do this video because this game does have quite a bit going on, but I think if we explain it in a pretty straightforward way, it'll make a lot of sense because it's not too terribly complicated. There's just a lot of things that are happening. So to start off, we're going to go ahead and show you the setup and how to prepare the playing area. So the first thing that everybody's going to want to do is they're going to want to set up their player boards. And there's a few different things that you're going to do to set up this player board. Just to give you a little bit of a rundown on what you're looking at here, this player board is where you're going to store active contracts that you're working on, which is a way that you complete victory points. Completed contracts, whenever you complete a contract, you put it face down right here. There's going to be these little spaces up here for all of the trading posts, which there's a lot of trading posts in the game that you can put down at different places when you travel. Space up here for all of your dice. And then there's a space here for your resources and your camels. So it's like you're putting your resources in your books and your accounting. So what you'll do to start off is you'll set up your player board. So let's get into the different steps of what you'll do for that. Alright, so for your player board, what you'll want to do is you will give yourself a starting contract, and these are what the contracts look like right here, and you can see that they all have different types of resources for money and victory points and things like that. You'll be able to tell the starting contracts because on the back of them they'll have a blue seal, and normally in the game the contracts will have a red seal. So each player will get one of these starting contracts, you'll shuffle them up, and then give one to each player, so we'll just get this one. And you put it here to show that it is one of your two available active contracts. The next thing that you're going to want to do is you're going to want to prepare your gather your player dice. These will be the ones that you use for the game. These are kind of like your workers. This is to me this is a worker placement game among other things. But your dice are your workers, and you place them on the board for completing certain actions. So you'll gather those and put them near your player board. You're also going to have a number of different trading posts, which you can see right here, and they'll be set up along the board here in a second, whenever we clean things up and make it look more neat. Everyone will also start the game with two camels, so you'll grab two of the little camel meeples and put them right here. And there's a bunch of different kinds of resources and meeples, and camels are just one of the little things that you will have. You will also give each player two destination cards, or I think they're called destination cards. The backs of the cards look like this, and there's a whole little deck that you can shuffle and hand out. And on the other side of these cards, they're going to give you different victory point bonuses if you can put trading posts in different cities that are listed. It's kind of like Ticket to Ride, kind of like destination tickets and Ticket to Ride. You're going to have, during the game, you can travel along these routes through Asia, and you'll be able to put trading posts on the routes where you go along the way. And these cards basically say if you can put a trading post in Alexandria and Kashgar right here, for instance, you'll get 5 victory points, which is what is listed. And then over here, this has Moscow and Ormuz. And the table along the bottom, that is if you get that total number of goal cities. So if you look at this card, it has 2 cities that will give you this number of victory points, and this card has 2 different cities that will give you those victory points. But if you get all 4 of these cities, you'll get the 10 victory points that are listed under 4. If you were to, for instance, have a trading post in Kashgar, Alexandria, and Ormuz, you would have 3 of your total goal cities, so you would get the 6 victory points listed below 3, and so on. So that's kind of how that works. And each player gets 2 of these. And then you will also get a starting character. Now this is one of the ones that the game recommends that you start with. This guy gives you a special ability, and this one just basically says that instead of rolling your dice, you can pick whatever you want your numbers to be, and the numbers will matter whenever you put these dice down on the board later. So this guy's got a pretty cool ability because you get to pick whatever type of resource or action you want, essentially. So you'll get him. And then after that, really the only thing that's left besides putting your meeples in the starting city is getting your starting money. And so I'm going to be pretending like I'm the first player. The first player gets $7, and the second player we get $8, third player we get $9, and the fourth player, should you have a fourth player, would have $10. So the last little bit after gathering up all of this stuff is putting your meeples on the board. Now, if you look up here, pretty standard fare as far as a lot of Euro games are concerned. There is a victory point track around the board. So what you'll do is you'll put your meeple next to the one so that you can start to track your score. And then your other meeple will be in Venezia or Venice to start the game. And after you've done that, the players are ready to go. And every player will do this. So you'll all get these types of resources, these cards, everything like that. And once you have all that stuff, you're ready to start setting up the board. So I'll show you what this all looks like once it's set up here in just a second. Alright, so we've got the player board set up, how it'll look for each player. You've got your resource, your turn dice right here. You've got your trading posts ready to be placed on the board. You've got your two goal cards. You've got your starting character, your money, and your starting camels. The other thing that the game includes that's nice to give to everybody is this little reference. It's a player aid that'll show you the different steps to a game round, and then on the other side it'll go through a list of all of the bonus actions that you can take, and we'll get into that in a little bit. But now we're ready to set up the board, and what we'll do is we will kind of go through the different steps that you need to take to get the board ready to go, and where you can easily find all of the tiles and the cards and things like that. And then after that, we will go through the actions and talk a little bit about gameplay. So let's set up the board. All right, so in setting up the board, one of the first things that you're going to want to do is lay out the contracts and separate them by round. The game has five total rounds, and the game comes with all of these contracts. And you'll see that these are different from the starting contracts because they have the red seal instead of the blue one that is on the back of our starting contracts. As you can see, they look different. So these are the main contracts that you'll be able to buy throughout the game. And what you want to do to prepare for the setup is you want to separate these into five different stacks of six, and then that will leave eight tiles left over, and that's a special stack that you may use in certain situations. But after you separate these into five different stacks of six, what you'll do is you'll put one of those stacks out on the board to be your starting contracts that you can get from the game. You'll have these eight left over. These you'll just set to the side. You may use them periodically throughout the game. And you'll put the first five contracts out on the board. It's completely random. You don't have to put them in any order. You want it to be randomized. So once these contracts are placed out on the board, you will put the remaining stacks of contracts off to the side. And at the end of every round, what you'll do is you'll clear off any contracts that haven't been purchased and put a stack of new contracts out, and that's how you keep track of the rounds. So as you can see, the contracts have been placed in their space up on the board, and the four remaining contract stacks as well as the special little contract stack are placed off to the side, ready to be used throughout the rest of the rounds. So now that we've placed out our contracts, let's talk a little bit about the different cities and what you'll need to do to set them up. Okay, so the next thing we're going to want to do is to set up the cities. Now you're going to look on the board, you're going to see that there are two different sizes of cities. There are the small cities, and then there are big cities right here, and you'll set them up a little bit differently. As you can see, the big cities have kind of a half semicircle up top, and then they've got all these spaces down below where we can put action cards. And these are different things that we'll be able to do once we get into the cities, and we'll go over that in a little bit. But to start off, to set things up, what you're going to do is you're going to take this deck of cards, shuffle them all up, and fill up all these action spots, and then whatever's left over you'll put in the box. And then you will randomly select tiles from the top of from this stack until you've filled up all the city spaces. And I'll show how those are set up here in a second. And then for the small cities, you'll shuffle up all these tiles and place them above these cities up here to show what bonuses will be achieved when you hit those cities. So let's set things up and then I'll show you what it looks like. All right, so now as you can see, every big city is going to have a bonus tile above it. And these tiles right here, these will show what kind of bonuses you get when you first enter the city. And then the spaces down below will have actions that you can unlock as you travel into the cities. Once you place down a trading post, you can take the actions that are located here. And then on these small cities, you're going to see that there's a tile above the main part of the city right there, and that shows a one-time bonus you get when you enter the city, and then a bonus you'll get at the start of every round as well. Now you'll notice that Beijing does not have any bonus tile that you can get when you enter the city initially, and that's because it has special bonuses that we will talk about later on in the explanation of the actions. Alright, so after all of the cities have been set up, really the last thing to do is to place these black dice above the marketplace down here, because these can be purchased and used throughout the game. And you're going to want to put all of the potentially gained resources over here on the side of the board. You can see that we have a whole lot of camels over there. We have some silk, gold, and pepper in that order. And those are the different resources that you will get throughout the game to complete contracts and get victory points and things like that. So what we'll do is we will go ahead and take a look around the board at the different action spaces, explain the actions, and then tell about the end of the game scoring. And then after that, you should have the basic knowledge that you need to get the game set up and give it a play. All right, I've taken the camera off the tripod because we're going to need to move around the board a little bit to explain the different spots where you can put your dice and take actions. Now, as I said earlier in the setup, I kind of see this game as a worker placement game because you are going to be putting these dice all around the board to take different actions. So there's all kinds of spots where you can put down dice and get a certain type of benefit or a reward. So I kind of see it like a worker placement game. That's a little bit different because you're not necessarily putting down workers, but it has the same basic principle. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to talk a little bit about your turn and what you can do, and then I'm going to go through each action one by one to explain in greater detail the things that can happen. Now, before I get going, I want to just explain a basic concept in the game that's going to be very important whenever you play. There are all these different action spots on the board, and I'll go over each one and what they do in a little bit. But what I want you to see is there's going to be spots where you're going to have to put more than one die down to take the action. So for this spot right here, you'd have to use two dice. When you go over to the marketplace, you're going to see to gain silk and gold, you would have to put down two dice and three dice to get those actions. Now what you're going to do, whenever you're putting down multiple dice, and whenever you're putting down one die really too, the number that's on your dice is going to be important. Because what you're going to do whenever you place down these dice is you're going to take the lowest number that you have. So in this case, let's just say for example, I was putting down a 6 and a 3. What I would do is I would put down this 6 and this 3 on this traveling space. And what this lowest number would do is unlock the third action and anything below it. So the lowest number on your dice is the greatest action that you can take. So in this instance, I could, if I wanted to, take this action that has a 3 listed, this action that has a 2 listed, or this action that has a 1 listed. I could not take the action that has the 4 listed because my lowest number is a 3. So that's a principle to use throughout the rest of the game. And the same thing goes for these spaces up here. If I were to put down a, let's just say for instance, a 4 and a 2 up here on the silk space, I could unlock and take any of these actions from 2 down. Other than that, I wouldn't be able to take any actions above that because my lowest number is a 2. That's generally the way that these dice work whenever you place them down. A lot of times whenever you put down the dice, depending on what number they have, is the strength of the action that you can take. Now, another thing to notice is that for your main actions, there's 5 different main actions that you can take. And you'll be able to see them because all of them have this little blue shading behind the dice. The only one that doesn't have the blue shading is this Khan's Favor. This is a main action you can take as well. But other than that, you'll be able to look around the board and see all the little blue dice that you can put down. If someone is already on a blue space, you can take that action still. You just have to pay to take the action. And the same lowest dice that you put down rule applies for that as well. So let's say, for instance, that another player, and this is not another player's dice, this is just some of the general dice that everybody can buy. But let's just say, for instance, that somebody else wanted to come and take this action. What you would do is you would place those dice on top of this action, and whoever was taking the action has to pay in dollars the lowest number that he puts down. So whatever player was wanting to take this silk action, if he put down these 2 dice, he would take the lowest die that he put down, which is a 2, and he would pay $2 for that, and then he would be able to take the action. So there's a little bit more that you have to do if you want to take the action where someone already has their dice. Now that I've kind of explained those general principles, I will go over the main actions that you can take and the bonus actions, and that's pretty much all you'll need to know to get going. Alright, as I said, there are 5 different main actions that you can take on your turn. There's also a number of bonus actions that you can take. But generally the way your turn is going to work is you can take any bonus actions, and then you can take your main action, and then you can take any more bonus actions that you want. So before or after your main action, you can take bonus actions, and then the meat of your turn is your main action. So that's kind of the way the timing works. The different main actions that you can take, you can either come over here to travel, you can come to the marketplace and get either gold, silk, pepper, or camels. You can come over here and get $5, simple as that. You can come down here on this yellow bar and try and gain the Khan's Favor. And this is kind of a cool spot because if you come here, you get to pick one of any resource that you want and you get 2 camels. So it's kind of a utility place that you can come and get some stuff that you might need to complete contracts. And then speaking of contracts, you can come here and get either 1 or 2 available contracts depending on how high the die is that you put down. So now that we've looked at the 5 different basic actions that you can take, let's go ahead and talk about them in their own separate sections. And the first thing that we'll do is we'll talk about traveling. Alright, so we're talking about traveling along the map. Now this is a big part of the game. What you'll do is you will put down action dice here, and then you'll pay the costs listed, depending on what action that you want to take, to move spaces along the board. Now, traveling is kind of interesting in this game because as you travel to different cities along the board, you're going to unlock different actions that you can take. You're going to place down your trading posts, which will potentially give you more victory points, and you'll get bonuses for going to these different cities. But traveling is pretty tough, and it's expensive. For instance, if you wanted to take the travel action, what you would do is you would have to place down 2 of your dice. So let's say we put down these 2 threes. Now, using the principles that we talked about earlier, this means that we have unlocked the 3 action and anything below it because our lowest number that we've put down is a 3. So if I wanted to, I could pay $12 and move my man 3 spaces along the map up top. I could also, if I wanted to, pay $7 and only move 2 spaces. Now this might come in handy because sometimes you may not have the money to move 3 spaces and, you know, you don't maybe need to move that far. So what'll happen is whenever you place your dice down here and you pay for these actions, you're going to move along the board and get into different cities. And the way cities work in this game is the first player to get to these big cities is going to get the bonus that's listed on these tiles right here, and then that tile is going to go away. So let's say, for instance, I wanted to move 2 spaces. So I've put down my 3s. That unlocks anything from 3 down. But I say, I don't necessarily need to move 3 spaces, I just want to move 2. So I would pay $7 to the bank, and then I would be able to take my meeple up here, and I would be able to move him along the track. Now there's roads, and there's oasis on these roads. So this counts as a stop. So if I paid $7, I could move 1, 2 spaces, and I would land in a city. Now when you land in a city, big or small, a couple things happen. When you land in these big cities, if you're the first one there, you get to take these bonus tiles, and you gain those goods instantly, or those bonuses. So this one says I get to pick 1 of any resource. So I could go over here and I could say, you know what, I want a silk. So I'm going to grab a silk. You take it, you put it down in this little book, and then this can either be put in the game box or you can kind of hold on to it. That's done. That bonus has already been taken. When you go into a city, you're also going to take one of your trading posts and place it in the city that you have landed in. And what that does is this unlocks this card to be used as an action. Now, city actions are really good. You can put them down, and depending on the strength of the die that you put down, you can take this action numerous times. So let's say, for instance, that I wanted to use this little city card, which says I can trade in a camel and a silk for 4 gold and 2 victory points. What you could do is in future turns, if you wanted to, you could put down any number here, and you could take that action as many times as the dice that you've put down, as many times as the number says. So let's say, for instance, I put down a 2. If I had 2 camels and 2 silk, I could use that action twice and get 8 gold and 4 victory points. It's a really powerful action. And these cities are interesting because you can't go there more than once. So if somebody goes here, these actions are blocked. You can't pay and go on top of that die. So it's pretty nice to be able to unlock city actions and take that bonus. Now, let's say, for instance, I was to come into a small city. The general principles will still apply. You'll put down one of your trading posts. But instead of unlocking one of these action cards up here, this gives you a one-time bonus when you enter the city, and then at the start of every round, it gives you the same bonus. So if someone traveled to this city, they would instantly put down one of their trading posts. They would get a gold, or 3 gold, excuse me, and a camel. And then at the start of every round, they would get that bonus again. So these small cities are nice as well. The only other thing to mention about traveling, is you're going to see on these roads that there are some roads that show plus 15 gold. There are some roads that show 4 camels. On these roads, to travel in between them, in addition to paying the traveling costs down here, you're also going to have to discard the resources that are shown on the road. So let's say, for instance, that my guy who's traveled to Moscow up here wanted to go over to Anxi. He would have to pay 3 gold and take the traveling action, and then he would also have to discard 3 camels to take that action as well. So it's a little bit, like I said, expensive to travel, but it can be very rewarding. But that is the traveling action that you can take as one of your main actions. So next, let's talk about the marketplace. All right, so what we're looking at here is the marketplace where we can go and get different resources that we will need to complete contracts. And you can complete contracts as a bonus action, and I'll go over the bonus actions here in a second. But the basic principle is you're going to have contracts, and I'll show you my starting contract down here. You're going to have contracts that say, it's as simple as it looks. If you turn in a camel and 2 silk, you get 5 gold and 3 victory points. And all of the contracts are that way. They have a requirement on the left and a reward on the right. So if you look at these different contracts, this one, for instance, right here says if you turn in a camel and 3 gold, you get 6 victory points and you get to pick 1 resource of any type that you want. You can either pick gold, pepper, or silk. This contract down here is a little bit more. It says if you turn in 2 camels, 3 pepper, and 2 gold, you can get 7 gold and 6 victory points. So these are pretty straightforward. You complete contracts, you put them on your
player board face down. And whoever has the most completed contracts at the end of the game gets 7 bonus victory points. So it's another way that you might be able to score some victory points at the end and get some bonuses. So for the marketplace, this is as simple as it looks, which actually probably looks pretty complicated to somebody who hasn't played the game. But the basic principle is you're going to put down dice to take an action. So let's just say, for instance, that we wanted to take the gold action. We wanted to get some gold. What we would do is, as you can see on the board, there's 3 dice symbols. So what you have to do is put down 3 dice. So this is an expensive action to take. And you can unlock the action that is equal to your lowest die. So like I said, I've put down a 3 here. So if I wanted to, I could get the reward that is listed under 3. And if I wanted to, I could also take 2 and 1. Now, you might be asking yourself, who would want to take less rewards? Who would want to take less resources? Well, let's say, for instance, that I've got a contract, that requires that I have a camel and 2 gold. Now, what I've put down right here is a 5 and 2 fours. So I've unlocked the 4 reward under this gold track, but it only gives me 3 gold. If I were to go down and pick the 3 reward, it gives me 2 gold and 2 camels. So I might want to pick something less than what I've put down to complete specific contracts. And the rest of these spaces on the market are the same way. You put down 2 dice for silk, and you can pick anything along the silk track, depending on what dice you put down, the numbers. You put down 1 die for the pepper track, and then you put down 1 die for the camel track. And that's the marketplace. So the next thing we're going to look at is the place where you can come and buy contracts. Now, contracts are useful for the game because in a very straightforward way, this is a really easy points generator. So you can come down here, buy contracts, turn in these contracts, and get points. Now, you can only have 2 active contracts at once. So I've still got a space open for this contract. But if you see something that you like better up here on the track, you can discard any of your active contracts at any time and get a new one. So you could come up here, for instance, and get 2 contracts, discard this one, and it just goes underneath this special stack over here, so you put it on the bottom. Now, when you come to the contract space, you can put down 1 of your die, and you can take either 1 or 2 contracts. So let's say, for instance, I put down a 5. What you could do is you could pick anything from 5 or less and take those contracts. So I could take any one of these that are open, assuming that they're still there. The other interesting thing to mention about these tracks is that if you put down a stronger die roll, so if you do a 6 or a 5, in addition to the 2 contracts that you can potentially take, you will get an added bonus. So if you put down a 6 and you take that contract, you will also get either 2 camels or 2 gold, as you can see from the top up there. If you were to take the 5 space, you can pick either 1 camel or 1 gold. And that's the contract space. You can come in and get new contracts to get points. All right, so these 2 spots where you can come and get gold and on the Khan's favored track, I wanted to talk about them at the same time because they're pretty straightforward. But we'll just discuss this one first up here. What you can do is if you put your die here, you're going to get $5 if you're the first one there. If you want to come there later, the same principle applies. You will just have to pay whatever is listed on your die, and then you'll get the remainder in money when you come to that spot. So let's say, for instance, that someone had come there with a 3, and then someone later wanted to come there. They could, as long as they put down a 2, but then they would only get $3. And of course, you'd have to put down a different color die. I just used the green for an example. So the Khan's favor track, this one, what will happen when you put your die down here, you can put down any number that you want to. So let's just say, for example, that someone put down the lowest number that they could. They would put down a 1. They would get to pick 1 of any resource, a gold, a pepper, or a silk, and get 2 camels as well. Now, someone may want to come here later. And the same rule applies. You can't have your color there more than once. But just to show for an example of what would have to happen next, someone could come here with a die number that is equal to or greater what's already there. So if somebody has a 1 here, somebody else could come with a 1, or with a 2, or a 3, or 4, or whatever. And, you know, say someone put down a 6 right there. Someone could come there later, but they would have to put down a 6 at least to be able to take that action. And once again, I'm just using these green die for illustration purposes. You would have to come there with a different color of dice. And that is the Con's Favor track and just the track where you can come get some money. Alright, so those are the main actions that you can take during the game. Now the other thing that we want to talk about and go over really quickly is the bonus actions. So the game, like I said, gives a really handy reference that each player can take to see the different actions that they can perform on their turn. Now, you can take a number of different bonus actions before or after your main action. So what you can see here is that there's different bonus actions that you can do before your turn or after your turn. And I mean, when I say turn, I mean taking your main action. So whenever you put down a contract, whenever you complete one, that's a bonus action. So say, for instance, I've got this contract over here. And actually, to complete it, I would just need one more silk. So I've got this contract that says I need a camel and 2 silk. What I could do is I could take the resources out of my accounting books here. I could put them back in the bank. And then I would get the reward that's listed on the right side of this contract. So I would get 3 victory points and 5 gold. I could then use that 5 gold in my main action later, and that might help me. Another bonus action that I can take is you can come to a little coin purse on the board with any dice that you have and get 3 gold. Now this isn't quite as strong as coming up here and getting 5 gold, but if you were to need just a couple of gold to complete a different action, you could come up here to this space and get 3 gold anytime you wanted to, as many times as you wanted to, as long as you have the dice to do it. So there's no limit on how many times you can do this per turn. If you wanted to, you could come here and take 5 actions in a row. You could put all of your dice down there, get 15 gold, and that could be all the turns you take in the round. That's one of the bonus actions that you can take. So you can do that before or after your main action. One of the other actions that you can take is you can spend 1 camel at any time to re-roll one of your dice. So let's say, for instance, I've got some dice right here and 2 is not what I need. What I could do is I could spend a camel and I could take this die and re-roll it and hope for something better. In this case, I got a 1. That's terrible. But it gives you a chance to negate some of the bad rolls that you might have. What you can also do is you can adjust a die roll by 1 by spending 2 camels. So let's say, for instance, that I had this 3 up here and I just needed 1 more to get a 4 action or something. If say I want to put down a 4 on the travel track up there and travel 4 spaces. What you could do is you could spend 2 camels and adjust this die up or down by 1. So in that case, I could spend 2 camels and make that 3 a 4. Or vice versa, if I wanted to make the 3 a 2, I could do that as well. The other thing that you can do, and this is really useful throughout the game, is you can spend 3 camels to buy one of these black dice that are above the marketplace. Now these are just extra dice that will give you more actions. You roll them whenever you buy them, and you can take actions with them throughout the rounds. Now these are really useful because they will extend your turn, and you can also use these as a different color from your dice. So say if you're the green player, this is a different color than your player dice. And that matters because on these main action boards, these main action spaces, you can go there if somebody's already there. But if you've already taken the gold action, for instance, you can't take it again with green dice. If you had, if you were able to buy 3 black dice, you would be able to take that action again even though you've already gone there once that round. So let's say, for instance, an easier example is the camel track. Let's say I've put down a 6 on this camel track. I've gotten 6 camels, and I need more camels to complete an action. What I could do is I could buy one of these black dice. And then I could put that on top of my green die that I've put down, even though I've already gone there. But normally, you can't do that. You can only go to one of these actions once per round. So say, for instance, I wanted to take this action again. If I were to put down a green die on top of that, you can't do that. Your color can only be on one of these main action spots once per round. So that's buying the black dice, and that's why it's useful and helpful. Now, those are all of the bonus actions and all of the main actions that you can take. And what you'll do is you will take bonus actions and main actions on your turn, and when you're done, you can say, I pass. The next person, clockwise to you, will take their turn, and it goes around the table until there are no more dice to be placed for the round. So you take as many actions as you have dice. And then after that, after everyone has taken all of their actions, you will clear this track of any contracts that haven't been purchased. You'll lay out 6 new contracts from one of these stacks on the side of the board over here, and you'll continue to play until the game is over. Now, that's basically the game. At the end of the game, what's going to happen is you are going to get points for having the most contracts completed. You're going to get bonus points if you have completed your goal, your little destination cards here. You're going to get 5 and 10 extra victory points if you've placed down your 8th and 9th trading posts. So if you travel quite a bit and you're able to place down those 2 trading posts, you'll get bonus points for that. And then you'll also get bonus victory points if you have been able to make it to Beijing. Now, those are the different ways that you can get extra victory points at the end of the game. The other thing to mention is that if you've made it to Beijing, the reward is at the end of the game, you can count any 2 resources that you have, and they don't count camels in that, but any 2 gold, pepper, and silk that you have can be converted to a victory point. Players that have not made it to Beijing can't get that bonus. And then you will also get a victory point for every 10 gold that you have. But you're not usually going to get a ton of extra victory points for gold. You have to have quite a bit to get extra points for that. And that's essentially the game. Whoever has the most victory points wins and is the most successful explorer. This game is a brain burner. It's a lot of fun, but it is definitely one that it's just like any other Euro game. There are a few strategies that are really powerful, and there's a few ways to play that work out really well, but you have to really have kind of that type A mathematical brain to do really well at this game. Now, I don't have that. I'm really more of an artistic person, but I love to play it. I just don't normally win, unfortunately. But this game is still a blast to play and one that I would definitely recommend picking up. I think they're kind of in between print runs right now, so they're kind of expensive. The game's kind of expensive on Amazon, but it should be back into local game stores and on Amazon fairly soon. One last thing to mention, this is kind of a question that a lot of people ask. These resources have different sizes. The meeples are different sizes. The small resources are worth 1. The big resources are worth 3. So that's just something to take note of. Other than that, that's the game. That's the Voyages of Marco Polo. A lot of fun. Definitely one I would recommend. We're going to do a feature review on the blog pretty soon. And I'll put this video up on YouTube so that you can see how to play if you're interested in picking it up. And until next time, I will see you at the table.